Good morning, viewers. Welcome to the studio of CIT and CERT in this live interaction program. I am Neeraja Rashmi from the Department of Education in Social Sciences. Today's topic of discussion is Goods and Services Tax. We have with us Sh.Sanjay Sharan in the studio today. Sh.Sanjay Sharan belongs to Indian Revenue Service, Customs and Central Excise. He worked in various capacities in Central Excise, Customs and Service Tax across India. He is also involved with the policy making while posted with the legal section of the Central Board of Excise and Customs, Department of Revenue, Ministry of Finance. He superannuated in 2017 as additional Director General of the National Academy of Customs, Indirect Taxes and Narcotics. Sh.Sanjay Sharan has also pioneered the conduct of training on rollout of GST for central government and state government offices all over India. He is also a government certified master trainer of GST and has taken numerous sessions on GST at reputed institutes and organizations. Sanjay ji, we welcome you to the studio of CIT and CERT.
Thanks for kind words.
Friends, we all know that Goods and Services Tax was introduced in July 2017. First of all, our viewers will like to know what is GST and why its introduction is considered to be one of the major tax reforms in India.
GST stands for Goods and Service Tax. To appreciate and understand GST better, we need to see the pre-GST regime. In the pre-GST regime, we had a number of taxes on both goods and services, and the taxes were both levied by the central government and the state governments. But both the governments were acting separately, working separately, with the result that credit of tax paid on one activity was not allowed for your payment of tax for your output services. But after coming of GST, most of the taxes have been merged, and also tax is levied at one point, at one base value by both central government as well as state governments, and there is no cascading of tax.
Yes.
So this is a very major tax reform. Further, what the government has done, that interstate barriers have been removed. There is no entry tax on interstate borders. Earlier there used to be long queues of trucks standing on borders. And then also what the government has done is that they have made everything online. Payment,
yes,
of tax,
yes,
the three major activities,
yes,
in taxation system, major activities.
Mm-hmm.
One is registration,
mm-hmm,
as we have planned for direct taxes,
mm-hmm,
and then payment of taxes and filing of returns. So all these processes have been made online, and that is on a common portal of GSTN by the name www.gst.gov.in. So the suppliers of goods who are trying to further their business, and which also indirectly generates employment also for,
mm-hmm,
the country,
mm-hmm,
they don't have to grapple with multiple taxation system of various,
yes,
various states,
mm-hmm,
and compliance system of various states. Also the rates have been made one.
Okay.
And major thing is that the those suppliers do not have to go to various places.
Mm-hmm.
They can do at one place. They don't even have required, they are not even required to go to a government office.
So, in a nutshell, you have summarized all the facilities given in the GST. So, let us discuss all these one by one. So, first of all, why it is considered, it is known as Single Comprehensive Indirect Tax, GST, and which covers from all stages of production, from production to sale, from manufacturer to consumer.
It is single comprehensive tax in the sense that what we have to appreciate in GST, that taxable event prior to coming of GST, we had major three major taxes. One was VAT, that was on sale of goods. Then we had central excise duty, major taxes I am talking of. Then we had central excise duty, which was on production and manufacture of goods. And we had service tax, which was on supply of services. But in GST, the crux, the catch word is supply. Every moment there is a supply, the GST has to be levied, and it is one tax for whole over the country for one goods or one services. And every moment they supply, the supplier, if he is above the threshold, normal threshold all over India is 20 lakhs, that is aggregate turnover for all over India, and for states of Northeast, seven states of Northeast, and Sikkim, Himachal and Uttarakhand, it is 10 lakhs, but that is also likely for many of them it is likely to be revised. So, they have to, supplier has to pay the tax, discharge the tax, of course, he receives it from receiver. But every moment he discharges, he will pay the same rate of tax at every stage. So, effectively the tax all over India in the intermediary chain becomes on the value addition.
Okay. So, just you said that it is a it is called comprehensive because it has included subsumed various types of taxes. So, as GST has subsumed and included and replaced, you can say, various types of taxes is levied by central government, state governments and UTs. So, can you name what are the major taxes?
The major taxes, yes. The major
replaced by GST. Yeah,
correct. Major taxes were central excise duty, which was levied by central government, service tax, which was again levied by central government, and then central government also levied a number of other taxes like additional duty of excise, textile and textile products, additional duty of excise, goods of special importance, and also some cesses like Krishi Kalyan cess and Swachh Bharat cess, they were also levied by the central government. And the state governments had VAT, luxury tax, entertainment tax, entry tax, purchase tax, taxes and lottery and gambling, and they had other cesses also that they used to levy on these goods.
So, broadly, all these, what is the number, what was the number approximately?
Yeah, it is 17 plus 23, total 40 taxes and cesses all have been subsumed in GST.
In GST. Yeah. So, total 43 number.
40
taxes and cesses have been replaced by
total
GST.
Total taxes plus cesses combined, it is 40.
40.
Yeah.
Another thing is that it is said that GST is a destination based tax with facility of input tax credit, which you probably talked also in the beginning. So, with the facility of input tax credit in the supply chain.
Yeah.
So, what does input tax credit mean?
Okay. Assuming somebody is supplying certain goods from Delhi to somebody in say Uttar Pradesh, and from further Uttar Pradesh it further gets supplied to somebody else say in Assam. So, the person who will be supplying from Delhi, he will pay the tax as per the rates. And whatever tax, supposing the value is 100 rupees and the rate of tax is 12 rupees, 12%, 100 rupees does not attract tax.
Yes.
So, he will pay 12 rupees as tax. And it goes to somebody in Uttar Pradesh, assuming he charges adds other values like transportation, insurance and his margin of profit makes it 150 rupees. Then on 150, 12% again he has to pay tax. So, he has got to pay 12%, that means 18 rupees. So, for 18 rupees discharge of tax, he can pay 12 rupees from the credit that will accrue to his account.
Yes.
Because there are two ledgers. Basically, there is a credit ledger and cash ledger. So, from credit ledger, he can pay 12 rupees of tax and from cash ledger, he can pay 6 rupees of additional tax that is required. So, credit of taxes paid at earlier stage is available to the further supplier in the supply chain. So, that is why it is working throughout in a type of input tax credit system, and tax effectively comes on a type of value addition for it.
So, in the pre-GST regime, taxes were imposed on the total value of goods, which included the taxes paid on intermediate goods also. So, that that led to cascading of tax or double taxation. So, how has can you explain in little detail how has GST removed or tackled this problem?
Let us take some example. Let us take an example of a builder or a chartered accountant. Builder was acquiring pre-GST regime, GST came from 1st of July of 2017, and the builder before coming off the GST, he used to, for building his apartments, he would require many things from the market like cement rods, cement, paints, varnishes, sanitary fittings, so many things. And it used to come VAT paid. But this VAT was not admissible to him for discharge of output tax. Now these are all coming GST paid. So from GST that he is paying on these products, he can utilize that GST which accrues to account and pay his output tax. So that is how cascading goes away.
Okay.
And more and as the central government and a state government, they are acting together. Earlier they used to work separately as per the constitutional arrangement. But now since they are working together, input tax credit, it's a GST and again GST to GST. So GST paid either goods are coming or GST paid services are coming, which are utilized for making of output goods or output services. From that tax you can pay that. So cascading has gone away.
It is also said that GST is applicable at a same rate throughout the country for a category of goods. So please explain this.
We have what? We have got central government, state government and UT governments. So any activity, any supply as such, whether it is of goods or whether it is services, we have four major slabs like 5%, 12%, 18% and 24%.
Four major slabs
are there. So and it is, if supposing somebody is supplying from here to Chennai, Delhi to Chennai, and the rate of tax is 12%, he will discharge 12% of tax. And if somebody is supplying from Chennai to Andhra Pradesh, again it will, for the same goods or same services,
12%.
It will remain 12%. So that is why it is no cascading of tax, and there is
single rate for one category of goods.
One category of goods and services as well.
Because so 12%, what are the mainly, what are the goods?
Many items, like we have refrigerator is there, many items of daily use, whatever we are buying from market, toothpaste, powders, and many things are on 12%. And 5% category of goods are which are packed goods, like packed branded, you know, cereals, branded pulses, branded atta, and all those things, they are 5%. But unbranded is out of GST, cereals, etc., they are 0%.
So, can you please repeat the four slabs of taxes?
Four major slabs are 5%, 12%, 18%, and 28%. But we have some smaller slabs also, like 3%. For, you know, precious metals, and 0.25% for, you know, diamond, etc., some diamond items.
So, there are altogether six slabs.
You can say six, we normally say four slabs only,
four
but
major,
these are very uncommon ones.
So, 3% for what? Some examples?
Some precious metals, etc.
3%. And 0.7%?
0% is for, you know, unbranded purses, unbranded atta, flour, so many, many things that don't attract interest.
Some of the products have been kept out of GST. So, what are these products which are kept out of GST, and why they are kept out of GST? And do you think that in course of time, these products which have been kept out of GST will be subsumed under GST?
Some of the products that have been kept out of GST are 5 petroleum products. Like crude petroleum,
5 petroleum products,
crude petroleum, petrol, that is motor spirit, high speed diesel, natural gas, and aviation turbine fuel.
Okay,
these are 5 which have been kept out of GST. And another, but these will come into GST within 5 years from the date of onset of GST. That means before 30th June of 2022, they will all flow back into GST. That is the arrangement.
22. Within 5 years.
Within 5 years from the onset of GST. And then we have one alcoholic liquor for human consumption. Alcoholic liquor, earlier also the state government used to levy taxes on them, state excise and state VAT. So there is no agreement on that to bring it under GST. So that will remain out of GST for till there is no date as such decided. That will remain out of GST.
So, mainly 5 petroleum products.
And they will come into, but these will come into GST.
And is there any specific reason why they are kept out of GST?
Because GST came because of agreement by the state governments and the central government,
mm-hmm.
we truly became a economic union after coming of GST.
Mm-hmm.
Before that, we were not a type of economic union. We were a political union, you can say federal structure, but not a type of. So, they have not agreed to that. There may be many reasons because states getting revenue for that, central government also getting revenue for that. States and central might have been wary as to how much tax will come to them, how they will offset all everything, how they will manage everything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we are getting GST up to the tune of about 1 lakh crore every month.
Mm-hmm.
That is what is happening. So, these will come, these five products will come, but alcoholic liquor for human consumption remains out of GST. State
and it will remain. And
there is no agreement on that, because it is a something where they amended the constitution that central government and state government should act together. So, they amended the constitution that on both goods and services, both of them can levy tax. But before that, on goods, sale of goods, states could levy tax, but they could not levy tax on services. This is what they have done. But here there is no agreement. So,
So in what you are saying that in course of by 2022, these five petroleum
products, from rolling out of GST,
these five petroleum products will also
come under GST. I think they will come before that. They should come before that.
Both
the governments should decide.
Yes.
And they decide to the GST council. GST Council, that is a statutory body.
Can you just throw some light about GST,
GST Council? They have made a GST Council under Article 279A of the Constitution. It's a federal body where the chairman is Union Finance Minister, then is Minister of State of Finance is also a member. All the finance ministers of various states, they are also members. And they normally take, the central government has got 1/3 of voting share, if the weighted average, and the state governments combined have 2/3 of voting average. So, this is a federal body which takes decision for GST for, you know, when the GST came, there were some rates, but people wanted the rates to be lowered. So, government has been lowering rates, but government could do it only after the recommendations of GST Council. They have, although it is a statutory body, but it recommends to the government. And thereafter, they bring notifications and circulars and other things. So, this is what it is. So, they will take a call on this and they will decide, this federal body will decide.
Whether rate and all these
rates,
things.
Rates, everything.
Rates and time.
Time, what credit, many things they decide. So, this should come before that.
Before that, that's the limit.
For five petroleum product. But
some of the economists argue that GST, introduction of GST will lead to higher rate of economic growth, and GDP is expected to rise by 2% after introduction of GST. On the other hand, some people feel that it will lead to a slowdown in the economy. So, according to you, which view is correct?
You see, coming of GST was a big change, and it was a momentous change, and it all, you know, happened with digitization. Everything became digitized, and people and trade might not have been ready for that. And then there was a problem of migration also to GST. They had to go online migration.
Okay.
These and other problems slightly slowed down when the GST came.
Initially.
2017, that GDP growth rate was 6.74%, and it escalated to in 18, 7.36%. And this first quarter of 2018, it is 8.2%. So, it is rising. So, it will definitely lead to rise of GDP by 1 to 2%. But initially, such a momentous change and migration and other issues, and the government also came up with lot of support to trade and industry. They have come with, wherever trade came, they have come with this support. Every place government has come.
So, what kind of support they
For exports, etc., they have to give bond. The government, and the simpler ways to give a letter of undertaking. They made letter of undertaking, and they reduced rates. So, many places they also said that it's for a small, you know, suppliers whose turnover is below 1.5 crores, they have to file. Today, we have two returns by the name of GSTR1 and GSTR3B. For a smaller suppliers up to 1.5 crores, they have said you can file quarterly returns. For others, they have said monthly returns for GST or 3B. Mm-hmm. Even for, you know, getting there was a Tran-1 form by which you could transfer a credit, claim your credit, whatever there in earlier regime. Mm-hmm. That also government has been extending dates. Mm-hmm. So everywhere government has been very helpful to trade. Mm-hmm.
So you, what you are trying to say that government has helped the suppliers.
Definitely.
And for the small suppliers,
bigger benefits
and
by quarterly returns of GST or one.
Yeah. So now I think there is no problem.
There are some problems happening because of certain issues, like people sometimes go to the file separate petitions. There is authority for advance ruling. Mm-hmm. And it is normally a state-based.
But more or less, the things are now settled.
You can say it is largely controlled. Mm-hmm. It is largely settled, not controlled, and people are happy with this GST.
People are happy.
Yeah.
So, but one thing I came to my mind that it was expected that and it is believed also that GST will reduce the overall cost of production. So, if the overall cost of production is reduced, it should get reflected in the prices of goods and commodities.
It is happening.
But consumers often complain that they are being charged higher prices on account of GST for goods in the market. So, what is the truth?
Truth is, I will tell you, when the GST came, say it came from 1st July 2017, assuming there was a shopkeeper at some place. Now he had already received his goods, which had come with payment of central excise and VAT.
Mm-hmm.
Now he had to discharge GST on that. Mm. So what he did on those taxes, on the value that he had, he levied GST.
Mm.
So initially there might have been those cases, but after that words, the prices of almost all the goods and services are declining, and that is declining because of allowance of input tax credit. So, fact is that the prices are going down,
but probably shopkeepers are charging higher prices on account of that because of GST.
There can be some guys who might be doing some mischief, but the government has said that whatever you get, supposing there is a registered shopkeeper and he is further supplying either in proper.
Maybe some shopkeepers are out of this, they are not registered.
They are not registered.
Registered. So they may be charging and they may be taking benefit of this GST and earning more.
But government has a scheme of, you know,
registering
that whatever benefits you get, either of reduction of income in tax or input tax credit,
mm-hmm.
they say that you should pass on to the next, you know, buyers. Receivers.
Yes.
And for that,
I think actually we all expected that prices will go down.
It is going down. It's a fact. It is going down.
Mm-hmm.
All along, it is going down.
One more important question. Many a times we keep hearing that GST is too complicated. Too complicated a system for common people to understand and to abide by. So, do you think how does GST work, and do you think any improvement is needed in GST in future?
I will say, as you speak about complications, because people had to shift from this, you know, manual system to online system, migrate to that, and all the compliance became online. That created some problems for the people.
And maybe different rates also?
Rates are not problematic, because rates are there, but one rate remains all over India for one goods, supplies of goods and one services.
But
that is not creating
but different
problem.
Goods, different categories of goods have different
but
rates.
Different categories of goods have different rates, but most of the rates are, you know, manufactured goods are between 12% to 18%. That is those are the rates.
Mm-hmm.
So, it is not creating that way problem. And people are able to further the things.
Mm-hmm.
What was the second part?
Asking that if it is considered by some section to be too complicated. So, do you think it can be further scope? Is there any scope of further simplification in future
government,
or any improvement?
Government has been making, you know, simplifications. Earlier, they had a form by the name GSTR3. They made an easier form by the name GSTR3B.
Mm-hmm.
That they have been doing. And for, you know, certain activities, they have said there are certain areas like some, you know, parts of goods, they are not clear where they are to be assessed, the parts at places they attract more rate of duty than the finished goods as such. Some small complications are there, and then also there are diverse rulings from, because there are authority for advance rulings in various states, and they have given some diverse rulings on the same areas in fact.
Mm-hmm.
Those things are smaller things are there,
mm-hmm.
but by and large it is working fine.
And if it's, I think it is only a year and
you can say 1 year and what, few months.
But it's now things are settled and
settled.
It's more or less working fine. And
yes.
Within 5 years, you are saying that everything will be.
5 years, those five things will come.
Five
but before that only itself,
simply.
You don't see also on interstate borders. You don't see lines of trucks.
Mm-hmm.
They can move more hours.
Mm-hmm.
They are also, in fact, there's a lot of saving on POL, petrol, oil, and lubricants also.
Mm-hmm. Because
so
of this.
Because entry tax have been abolished. So, so many things have been done.
Mm-hmm.
And they are all leading to growth.
So, what another, just it was coming to my mind that, you know, what impacts on small scale industries and maybe?
Small scale industries are also further. Government has been reducing taxes for them, smaller
mm-hmm.
activity, and the government in a different way. Some time back, they gave so many benefits to MSME, not GST benefit,
mm-hmm.
but MSME, they have given some benefit to MSME
mm-hmm.
regarding their, you know,
MSME.
They have given micro, small, and micro, medium, and small industries, they have given like that.
Benefits.
Benefit they have given.
Mm-hmm.
That way, they are benefiting government there also.
Benefits in terms of what?
Some loans, etc., they have given,
yeah,
not exactly from GST, some many systems they have.
Okay. Okay.
Recently, they have given big benefits.
So, basically, what GST is a very welcome step according to you, and we became truly an economic union after introduction of GST.
Correct.
So, how would you like to summarize for the viewers this GST and its introduction and its future? For the
GST is a gigantic social reform of this country, economic reforms of this country, and it has made everything online
mm-hmm.
and things are easier. There is no cascading of tax. There is allowance of input tax credit of the taxes paid at prior stages, with the result that prices of goods and services both are going down, and they will go down. And one very important thing, that when GST came, we had about 166 lakhs of assesses.
Okay.
Now recently we have got 1 crore 20 lakhs of assesses.
So
it's almost double.
1 crore.
20 lakhs, recent survey is that, recent information is that, almost doubled within say 1 year plus of
so
coming of
GST. So it has widened the tax net.
Tax net has been widened. And that is why it also helps government or through
generating
the GST Council
more
to reduce the taxes also.
Mm-hmm.
Tax rates are lesser as compared to earlier.
So, tax net has widened and more and more people are covered in this.
Covered in that.
So, that way government is benefiting.
Government is benefiting, people are also benefiting.
People are also benefiting, and there is the tax avoidance is maybe probably going down.
Yeah, it's going down, but some people are coming, creating mischief. So, wherever the information comes,
mm-hmm.
they are taken to task.
Mm-hmm.
Informations have come, misutilization of credit without supply of goods or wrong invoices.
So,
Those things
are being taken into account.
Wherever the information comes to the government, they are being taken into account. So,
okay.
It is a reform which will really helping us,
mm-hmm.
and it is a win-win situation for everybody, both for government as well as trade, as well as for the consumers.
Because
it's a win-win situation for everybody,
for government by earning more revenue, mm-hmm. and for the trade by
facilitation.
And then rationalization of rates and these things, and for the consumers in terms of
reduction of prices of goods and services,
and for the country also we discussed that maybe one of
larger revenue for the country,
larger,
yes,
and higher rate of growth also, probably
higher rate of growth, definitely. So that way it is a gigantic reform,
and so Now, GST, so viewers, we talked about the how it is single comprehensive indirect tax and which covers all stages of production from sale to from production to sale, from manufacture to consumers, and it has replaced various types of taxes levied by central and state government and replaced by one tax, and it is a destination based tax with facility of input tax credit, and it is also a on the total value of goods. So, it's cascading of tax and double taxation is being avoided. So, and it is applicable in the entire country in a single rate at a category of goods, and within 5 years of five petroleum products which are kept out of GST will be brought under GST within 5 years of time. So, it is a very positive step which government has taken, and it is as our expert Sanjay ji has said that it is a win-win situation for everybody, for all stakeholders. So, therefore, thank you Sanjay ji for coming to this studio and enlightening us. Thanks, about GST.
My pleasure.